Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Lilith's Quarry here inside the AWC on the campus of Loras College for what should be a very, very exciting game between crosstown rivals, last game of the regular season, the visiting University of Dubuque Spartans, and the home team Loras College Dewhawks. I'm Adam Rodriguez, and joined with me today is my go-to guy, Hugh Maloney. Hugh, how are we feeling today?
Oh, Adam, after that introduction, I'm feeling a lot better than I was coming into this game, and I was already feeling pretty good. So let's just say I'm feeling ecstatic.
Absolutely. This game has been built up to be just as exciting as ever. Both teams met earlier. Loras would take the first matchup, winning that one 76-65 down the road at UD's place. So expect another exciting one here today.
Yeah, always exciting when these two crosstown rivals meet up, and it's always a little extra physical in this game as well.
Yep, good steal there to start off with the Dewhawks, and Molstad's going to start the break. And Hugh, Molstad thought about it. Three-pointer, no good. And a board there from Simon. With UD getting that ball, Hugh, you want to go ahead and give us a starting five for the Spartans.
Yeah, bringing up the ball right now for the Spartans is their point guard number 20, Sam Kielberg. And then their other really go-to player is senior number one, Brock Simon. And then Sunday John getting the start, as well as Jalen McCandis and Dylan Anderson.
Yeah, absolutely. And like you said, Kielberg and Simon, a very, very talented backcourt for the Spartans. Good take there from John, but no good. But Kielberg, a very impressive performance not too long ago against Central, having 32 points. Ooh. And Basleip unable to go there. But a very high-explosive offensive team are the Spartans, as well as the Dewhawks. Kielberg up top, guarded by Barry here. And I mentioned senior day today for both the women and men for the Dewhawks. The women, it was a dominating performance in their game prior to this, and celebrating those seniors in a very fantastic performance.
Just smothering defense right there by the Dewhawks. Good job by Tyler as well. He's given up a little bit of weight in that matchup.
Absolutely.
T-Bass listed at 190. Anderson listed at 220.
So this three-pointer, no good. And Hugh, you want to give us a starting five for the Dewhawks.
Yeah, you just saw right there Declan Serlich from three right there, number 25, a senior. And then also another senior, number 20, Miles Berry. Got a couple more seniors coming up here as well as number three, Ali Sabet, really the go-to guy to get this Dewhawk offense going. And then his counterpart, number two, Jackson Molstad, the transfer. And then at in the last position, number one, Tyler Bass.
Yeah, absolutely. You said it. And four seniors out on the court, the only four seniors for this Dewhawk squad. They also have Colin Nelson, who is one of their assistants here. And a good move there from McCants to get that first bucket to go.
Yeah, McCants really just kind of flew up there and rose above the Dewhawk defenders and using that great verticality to his advantage.
Bass almost traveled there. Dewhawk just moving around. And the Spartans, a very good defensive team. Barry catch, shoot three, no good. But the Spartans, very good defensively. They swarm the opposing team's offense outside that three-point line and make it very difficult to go inside. Anderson's three-pointer. Oh, a short air ball. And this Dewhawk crowd's going to let him hear it.
Yeah, they'll probably let him hear it for the rest of this game. As we heard it in the women's game, they were doing it the whole entire time after that first quarter air ball. But going back to the stifling UD defense, I think the way the Dewhawks can beat that is just running in transition and using their speed to their advantage.
Right.
But that'll be hard as UD is a very athletic and quick team.
It's going to be a travel call there. Good defense by the Spartans down low. And, I mean, we mentioned the defense. UD only allowing 63 points per game are their opponents. And for Loras, I believe either the top or the second highest scoring team in the ARC coming into today's game, averaging 86.7 points per game throughout the season. So a very high power offense for Loras. Good take there from Kielberg. Better defense, Pearson.
Oh, a little miscommunication.
Oh, great hustle from Pearson to get it to Serlich.
Yeah, but going back to this high-powered Dewhawk offense, that's kind of Coach Martin's style of play, allowing them to go out there and get their shots up.
Right. Molstad drive left. Good take there. And, oh, good block from Kielberg. And now Simon's going to start the break for the Spartans. McCandis throwing down.
Man, talk about throwing down the hammer.
That starts on the defensive side, and just a great breakout pass there to get it up to McCandis from Simon. And then, obviously, McCants just throwing that one down.
That's a good start here for the Spartans, especially on defense here. Sabet.
Oh,
misses the layup.
Yeah, not going to see that very often from Sabet. A left-handed layup that doesn't drop. Very good around the rim, especially on that left-hand side. And a good poke from Kerlick there. Sunday John's three-pointer. Good.
It's a nice shot there by Sunday John. Only a 29% three-point shooter coming into today, so if he starts hitting those shots, right, it'll help the Spartans come out in this game.
Yeah, and we saw a similar start to this at the in their first matchup at UD. The Duhawks started out really hot. Molstad, I believe,
yeah,
knocking down
on
triples
fire
right out the gates. So a very opposite start in this matchup. Now Sabet up top. Going to work on my cans here. Good screen from Haynes. Step back three-pointer. Good.
That's a big shot for Ali. Just see him let it go through the net early, and then he's the type of player, once he sees it go through once, he's going to start heating up real quick.
Yep, and Ali, their last matchup, Ali had 23 in their first meeting, and a good take there from Kilberg.
That's good hands,
yep,
right there as well by Ali.
And it's going to be last touch by the Duhawks, and it's a Spartan ball. Miles Berry going to check back into the game for Jackson Molstad. And number 15, Tatum Argelo checking in for the first time this contest.
Yeah, Duhawks before that three-pointer by Ali were 0-6,
yeah,
to start this game as well.
Yeah, and getting great shots, and Simon's three-pointer, no good, but getting really good shots, but unable to convert any of them. And now Duhawks going to start a break here. Barry's going to start it.
Yeah,
push
not a
over
lot of numbers
Sabet
there for the Duhawks.
Possibly had Kerlick there in that left corner. But now the Duhawks just going to move it around here. Sabet guarded heavily by Anderson. Anderson, a very good defender on this Spartan squad.
Yeah, and a lot of these Spartans are good defenders, as you talked about, mm-hmm, only holding their opponents 62 points a game.
Yep.
And that's because they can guard 1 through 5 practically.
It's going to be an offensive foul there, and a great, great help there from Anderson just to step over and cut off Sabet trying to drive to the lane.
Yeah, it's this lower crowd is going to let them,
yep,
let the officials know what they think. He's got a couple of subs coming in here for the Spartans. Number 0, Wiley Sherburn, as well as number 11, Grady Thompson.
Yeah, and Dylan Anderson, that the one to take the charge there, he's, I mean, a graduate. And he's just a leader for the Spartans team, really does almost everything for him. Super physical on the defensive side and very physical down low when he gets the ball in the post on the offensive side.
Yeah, and that's kind of something that's gone away in today's game, is being a physical presence,
yep,
inside the paint on both sides.
And Arguello able to come away with that offensive board. He's going to get another possession, a good dump down, and a good block there from Haynes.
Oh!
And they're going to call a foul there on Haynes. That was another big thing in that first matchup between these two teams. Foul count in that first matchup. Very one-sided, you could say.
Yeah, and Coach Martin is letting the official know about the call. Wanted on his side as well.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, in that first matchup, 26 Loris fouls to UD's 12 in the first matchup. UD would shoot 36 free throws, and Loris only shooting 14 in the first matchup. Sherburn, able to connect there.
And free throws are a huge, huge part of winning basketball games.
Yes.
And I believe that the student section has a missed free throw counter going on a whiteboard down there.
Berry up on the right wing, guarded by McCants now. Duhawks doing a really good job moving the ball around here, and Berry going to catch, shoot, three-pointer. Good!
Nice. Yeah, Miles shooting over the taller McCants there, but he's got such a nice arc,
yes,
on his shot that,
yep,
it just went right over him, no problem.
Yes, Berry a very good catch-and-shoot three, or a very good catch-and-shoot three-point shot, excuse me. He doesn't really like to shoot it off the dribble, but if he can get it right in rhythm, he'll most likely knock it down. Three-pointer from Arguello. From Thompson, good.
That was good ball movement by the Spartans. Really got the Duhawks out of position, and then you saw at the end there Tyler Bass scrambling to get to Thompson, who made the three.
Berry just going to dish it over to Sabet. Guarded by Thompson, out Bass. Going to facilitate the offense here, and Pearson trying
He's
to get a mismatch.
Berry in the corner.
Bass kick out. Berry, three-pointer. Good!
Get hot, kid.
Yep. Again, like I said, Barry loves catching it in rhythm.
Yeah, Barry's been here all 4 years, as we've talked about on previous games, played all 4 years as well. Yes. And you know this rivalry runs deep, especially for Miles.
Oh, yes. And a great defensive possession there and a good touch from Barry. And it is all Duhawks right now. A lot of momentum on their side. Still trailing one. You can feel a small momentum shift over to the Duhawks.
Yeah, and this crowd is going to play a huge factor in this game, as it always does. Both sides bring an enormous amount of fans. And even at UD, there's a lot of Loras fans in the crowd.
Yes.
Probably one of the loudest crowds that you'll hear in a Division III basketball game.
Oh, yeah. Garrett Baum over checking in for the first time today for the Spartans. Anderson and Simon both check back in as well. And Jackson Molstead coming back in as well. And a good take there from Arguello.
Yeah, Arguello just really went up against a much smaller defender, Molstead, there.
Yeah.
And that's really why that was an easy bucket for him.
Den Duhawks trailing at 12-9 here. We got 12 and a half minutes left in the first half. Pearson three-pointer, no good. Unable to come with the rebound. It's going to be a foul, I believe, on
University of Dubuque.
Yeah, on UD.
Arguello, I believe, is what they call that one on.
And Curlick going to check back in for the Duhawks.
And I mean, I don't want to jinx it, but this first 8 minutes kind of flown by as well. But knowing that, it'll probably become maybe one of the longest 12 minutes and 26 seconds of basketball history.
Molstead inbound to Curlick. Just right back to Molstead. He's going to get the offense going. Drive left. Oh, good touch from the UD defender. Loose ball, and Bass able to dive right on it, and it's going to be a jump ball.
Good timeout by Miles.
Oh. Yep, great awareness there from Barry.
And that's just stuff you can't teach right there, is the awareness to call timeout, and the hustle is something that a lot of people talk about, is how you can't coach hustle. And you just saw Molstead, Bass, and Barry all on the ground for the Duhawks going after that ball.
Right. And like I mentioned earlier, senior day today for both the men and women. And the four seniors today, Hugh, you mentioned the starting lineup of Molstead, Sabet, Barry, and Curlick. Obviously, Molstead, the transfer from Wartburg, as you mentioned, and we've talked about it in other broadcasts, but just a fantastic addition to this Duhawks squad to a really already high, powerful offense. Bringing him in, the leading scorer from Wartburg, super shifty, outside the arc, can pull it from anywhere, and so good around the rim.
Yeah.
Just such a great addition.
And the reason it's even a greater addition is because he knew his role coming in here. He knew that Ali was the go-to guy for the Duhawks and that he'd kind of have to pick and choose his spots. And he really plays well off of Ali because that allows Ali to play off the ball as well. I mean, we know how good he is on the ball too, but adding that to Ali's game is huge.
Good take there from Curlick. Right at the last second on the shot clock, and great defense from Anderson and McCants. McCants able to slide over to the help, but Cerlick able to float it right over his hand.
I mean, the Duhawks they seem to come out with a lot more energy after they came out of that slow start. They've really picked up the pace, especially here on defense.
Right.
They're playing really good face guard defense. They're not allowing anything.
Anderson three-pointer, no good.
Yeah, it's going to be a
foul.
I was gonna say.
Yep. Foul there on Baum over.
Ali's the best one to check back into the game here. The Duhawks as well for
Haynes.
Look at you, taking the words right out of my mouth, Adam.
And we talk about a lot of the stepping up roles for some of these seniors, and we talk about Molstead, but Haynes last year got quite a bit of playing time last year, I mean, as a sophomore, but this year really blossomed into a go-to guy off the bench and even some starting minutes for him, but just a great role out of Haynes this year.
Yeah, and you can't emphasize enough the importance of having a big man come off the bench that you are confident in to, you know, hold down the defensive anchor as well as be able to put up points on the offensive end.
Yep. And it's going to be foul there on Anderson. That one a little close.
That looked like
a questionable call. Pretty clean steal from up here. Anderson wasn't too happy about it.
Yeah, and oftentimes I feel like that for the official, they're just kind of maybe anticipating a foul with that rip through.
Right.
It's kind of hard just to get a clean hand on the ball, but it looked pretty clean from up here, I thought.
And Sam Kilberg checked back in for the Spartans. It's going to be a legal screen,
Well, that's going to be a key for this Duhawk offense, is to use those off-ball screens to get their shooters open that we saw them trying to do right there. And Molstead was open off the double screen, so just look for that later in the game.
Yeah, and UD, with how physical they are, it makes it tough for Loras to get those good screens set and not have to worry about those offensive fouls.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, a great idea there from Simon. A good read, but John and maybe a little miscommunication there.
Yeah, and he let John know it on the walk back as well.
Yep.
And interesting having Ali guard Simon, as Simon is one of the facilitators here on the offense, averaging 10 points a game.
Right.
And I'm surprised they put their best score on Simon.
So if they can drive left. Oh, good help there from McCants to get a touch on the try to pass out to Barry. Now Kilber's going to start the break here, going to get the offense going. No, but you said Simon, a facilitator, not their main scorer, but, I mean, averaging 10 points a game. So, when he gets a chance, he'll look to score for sure.
Yeah, and he's second on the team in assists by – he's behind Kilberg by 9. So.
Yep.
And he's listed at 6'5", and I think he may be a little bit taller than that as well.
Yeah, yeah. 6'5", and just a super good athlete.
Yeah, yeah.
You see him on the defensive side. If a
that's really
Duoc
where
player gets in, he's up.
Yeah, that's really where Brock thrives is that defensive side. It's kind of a different role than what he played in high school. He was more of the scorer in the high school team because, you know, obviously, like you said, more athletic.
Right.
And then coming here, his second school that he transferred into, and he's really had to switch his role. But props to him to be able to have that mindset to switch more of a defensive role.
Absolutely. And McCants at the line misses the first one. McCants coming into today's action at 68% from the charity stripe. So it. Just say average free throw shooter.
It's about a D plus, C minus range.
Yeah. Unable to get either to go. Bass, good strong rebound there from Bass. John maybe a little contact from behind, but Bass able to just come away with it.
And John's playing smothering defense on Molson. Good move.
That's gonna be short. Simon's gonna get the rebound now. John just gonna slow up the offense. McCants going to look to go to work here on Curlick. Curlick, an undersized big, but so good down low on the defensive side.
That's just all like the muscle that he has there. What he lacks in height, he makes up for in muscle, as we saw. McCants try to back him down there.
Good defense possession here for the Duhawks. 8 seconds on the shot clock. Now Simon going to try to go to work here on Sabet.
Yeah, a little bit of a mismatch here.
Yeah, and that's a strong take from Simon.
Yeah, and he's just so much taller than Ali about It says 3 inches on the listed roster, but I don't know about that one.
Sabet driving.
Oh my!
Tough take from Sabet.
Just a kiss off the glass, floating it over the taller defender.
Like I said, just so, so good around the rim. And that first miss that we saw at the layup, not going to see a lot of those very often.
Oh.
The defense from Molstad.
Yeah, you saw Tyler Bass kind of fly out there, and Anderson was open on that cutback. John just missed him.
Beauty moving around. Skip pass to Kilberg. Sarvis guarding him pretty heavily here.
Sarvis is all on Kilberg.
3 seconds. He's got to get a shot up. And he does. And it's no good. And Sabet able to come in with the rebound. Great defensive possession for Loris there.
Yeah, good job by Sarvis as well, not jumping on that pump fake by Kilberg, knowing the shot clock was going down. It could have been real easy for him to go out there and commit a foul.
Almost taking a drive left, kick over to Sarvis. Sarvis three-pointer from the corner, no good.
Oh wow.
John out of nowhere with that rebound. John, another very athletic guard for this Spartan squad. You see him in warm-ups just jumping out of the gym.
I mean, you saw it there. He's kind of just floating in the air to get that ball.
McCants in rhythm, three-pointer, no good. It's going to be a foul on
UD, I believe.
Yeah. It's going to be on Sunday, John. It's going to be his first. Haynes and Barry both checking back in. Sabet and Bass both going to take a quick breather. We got 8:17 left here on the clock in the first half. A low-scoring first half so far.
Yeah.
Spartans leading at 14-13.
Yeah, and I think the coldness outside may be playing a factor for these guys just a little bit. UD shooting 40%, the Duhawks shooting 38%, so not really lighting it up by any means.
Right.
Two Spartans ran into each other there.
That's a drive kick to Sarvis. Sarvis almost looked like he traveled there. Going to drive, a little jump shot floater, and that one's good from Sarvis.
I mean, that's just a tough bucket.
It is.
He made that look
bucket.
A lot easier
than
what it really is. Just the composure, take that step back, and once again, McCants in the middle. They're just somehow getting all their shots over him.
Yep, Sarvis able to get a touch on that one. And now UD's going to have to reset here. Simon bringing it up. Kilberg, guarded by Barry. Barry, again, we've talked about it before, very good defender on the guards. A good step back from Kilberg in the three, no
Same
good.
Team.
And a good strong board from Haynes, and now Barry's going to start the break. A little handoff to Molstad. Molstad drive, right hand, no good at the rim, but Haynes, his putback over. Barry thought about the three-pointer. Now they're going to go let Haynes go to work. Jump hook.
That's a tough shot.
Yeah, I think Simon possibly could have gotten a touch on that.
Yeah. But we saw right there when the Duhawks run with the ball after a miss by the Spartans, it's hard for UD to set up that great defense.
Yep. Simon, a very short three-pointer. And the crowd is going to let him hear this one.
As you see it on your screen right there, they're letting him hear it. And a smart timeout here by UD.
Yep.
Kind of get a reset going.
Yeah. And Duhawks leading at 15-14. 6:58 left on the clock in the first half.
Yeah, and it doesn't really feel like any team is leading right now either.
No.
The fans on both sides aren't really into this game quite yet. I mean, I know we still have a whole nother half to play, but usually, especially with the Duhawks taking the lead, you would have thought it would have been a little louder in their home gym. But, yeah.
I mean, with how the two teams are playing, this is exactly what you'd expect in a rivalry game like this. Very physical.
Yeah.
And lots of great defense, making it hard for each team to get any easy buckets.
Yeah, and if you viewers at home are one to, like, watch high-scoring offense, the game may not be for you currently. But if you like the defense, don't turn that channel.
And Barry, Barry leading the Duhawks with six. Sabet right behind him with five. And Jalen McCants at four leading the Spartans. Sunday John and Grady Thompson both with three. Both teams out of their respective huddles. Loris is going to inbound the ball from the baseline, and Molstad's going to bring it up and get the offense going for the Duhawks.
Yeah, Barry, Duhawks using the screens here again early.
Yep.
Oh, Molstad's wide open on the wing.
And a great touch there from Arguello to get the ball out of the hands of Sarvis and force the turnover. Now Kilberg just going to slowly bring this one up for the Spartans.
Yeah, I think when UD slows the pace down, this is definitely more of their game. They like to clamp down on defense, and if they can really slow it down here on the offensive side, that will almost certainly slow down the Duhawks pushing it in transition.
Absolutely. Kilberg going to work on Barry. Kick out to McCants. McCants will shoot the three. That one's good.
Yeah, as you see the Duhawks, kind of hesitant to go out there and guard McCants. 20% free throw shooters. I mean, three-point shooter, so they're going to let him shoot that.
Oh, yeah. And Molstad's three, no good. Molstad quiet here in this first half. McCants going to drive in. Kick out Arguello's three-pointer. No good. Front rimmed. This is going to be last touch by Anderson. It's going to be Duhawk ball. Bass and Pearson both going to check back in for the Duhawks. And Thompson going to check in for the Spartans. Barry going to bring it up for the Duhawks. 5:50 left in the first half. Duhawks trailing at 17-15. Big block there from McCants. Oh, and it was going to be last Kilberg out of bounds, and McCann's block just hits right off the leg of Kilberg.
I thought Kilberg may have still been in bounds with that
one. I thought so as well, but I think that's what McCants is trying to plead a case there, but McCants laughing at it. He recognized that.
That was a heck of a block,
too. Oh, yeah.
And looking at this offense out for the Duhawks right now, the personnel, a lot of the scoring is going to have to come from probably Miles Barry, but he's, like you said, he's not much of off-the-dribble kind of guy.
Yeah, he... His go-to when he's going off the dribble, Barry loves the drive and the floater. Mm-hmm. That's his go-to when he goes off the dribble. But, again, just so good in rhythm with a catch and shoot. Went from a Sabet driver, a Molstad drive to a kick. And a good find to Kilberg and a good strong take, and it's going to be foul, and Kilberg's going to go line for two. And Kilberg, a 53% free throw shooter.
Rarely do you see a guard with that low of a free throw percentage.
And he's just going to knock down that first one. Yeah, Kilberg, the second leading scorer on the Spartan squad, averaging right around 14 a game. Kilberg knocks down both. Duhawks trailing by four. West Stride got to get some momentum on their side. Good drive and take from Barry, and that's going to be a block, and Barry's going to go to the line for two. Just a smart read there from Barry to read that pretty lackadaisical defense by the Spartans there on that possession.
Yeah, Miles a very smart player. He's only shot 17 free throws on the season, shooting at 82% right now. But, you know, Miles has a lot of stuff that you can't really coach in the game, the way he sees it and the way he distributes the ball on offense as well as the way he plays on defense.
You said it, just so smart. And that's what you want from one of your captains, one of your leaders of this team.
Yeah, and like you talked about, these seniors kind of came in here, and they really changed the program around for the Duhawks. They were ranked earlier this season. They're picked to finish second in conference. And then even Molstad and Sabet, who weren't here all 4 years, and like we already talked about Molstad being a great addition in this one season here, and Ali coming in here a couple years ago, he's really been a game changer for the Duhawks.
I mean, just their go-to guy, I mean, averaging 19.5 points a game. So everything looks to go through him. They love giving him that rock with the 10 seconds on the shot clock, let him do his thing in the ISO.
Yeah.
And then we talked about the other seniors, but Kerlik, we mentioned him in the past. So, I mean, he's very good defensively, and we talked about his frame, not the tallest, but muscle-wise, he's so good down low on defense.
Declan does a lot of stuff that doesn't show up in the stat book.
Yep.
When he alters a shot, or just like you said, down low in the post, affecting the back down.
And Simon's first free throw, good. Simon is 70% free throw shooter. And both are going to be good.
Yeah, and Ali's got to be smart here as well with two fouls already. You can't pick up a third. That'd really put the Duhawks in a tough situation.
Right. Good screen there from Kerlik. Sabet could have taken it off the screen. Bass, three-pointer. No good. McCants, good strong board.
Duhawks kind of gone on a little bit of a drought here
the
past couple minutes. They really need to have to figure that one out.
Oh, yeah.
Otherwise, this game may get out of hand. Is we've seen plenty of times where an 8-point game has seemed like a 15-point or 16-point game.
McCants going to drive in on Kerlik, go left side, lost the handle. They're going to say last touch by Kerlik. Kerlik with a good hand to make him lose it, and it's going to say Spartan ball.
And once again, that's one of the things that we just touched on, is that's stuff that doesn't show up in the stat book that Declan does, is swatting the ball out of bounds, forcing an inbound.
And the Spartans are going to have 8 seconds on the shot clock. McCants going to just go to work. Pull up floater off the board. No good. Bass, good rebound. And now Bass going to start the break. Give it to Pearson. Pearson, no good on the layup. And they're going to say a blocking foul. I'm not sure I agree with that one. Kilberg was just standing there. And I think from what it looked like, Pearson tried to jump around him. And really no contact on that layup attempt, but Pearson's going to get bailed out on that, and he's going to go line for two.
Yeah, and Kilberg, I mean, great play on his part. He was set there for about 2 seconds before Pearson came down, and it was smart by Pearson to try and avoid the charge. Like you said, a little bit of a bailout.
Oh, yeah, and Pearson's first one's good.
And Pearson, right around 90%, coming in at 89.7%. So somebody that Coach Martin loves having up there at the line, because he cuts it down to a two-point game.
Absolutely. And just a great guard to have coming off the bench.
Oh,
very good offensively. And, yeah, Kilberg shifting Barry there just quite a bit. Arguello drive right on Sabet. And it's just a good take from Arguello. And that's probably the defense that you want from Sabet, not to get that third foul.
Yeah, and right now I think – UD Spartans may have to go, as Chris Smoove would call it, a little bit of whoever offense on Ali. So who's ever guarding, kind of attacking, because you know he's not going to want to pick up that third foul.
Bass drive left, lost the handle just a bit. Barry swing over to Pearson. Pearson, oh, good. Good defense there from Thompson, able to cut him off, but just enough body for the ref to call that blocking foul.
Yeah, and if he would have been there about half a second earlier, I think it would have been a clean call. Clean play, excuse me, as there wouldn't have been a call, so it couldn't have been a clean call.
Right. And Pearson at the line for two more. Sarvis checking back in, and one thing to note for the Duhawks, Bass still sitting at 0 points. A very quiet evening for Tyler Bass, who is the third leading scorer on this team, averaging just right around 12 points.
Yeah, he's going to
have to turn it up here for the Duhawks for them to have a chance here in this game. I mean, he's only taken two shots, one three, and then a layup as well. So he's going to have to look to, you know, get his shots. As that may not be something that the other players besides Ali or Molstead are comfortable with, but he's going to have to kind of step up into that role.
Right. And Pearson able to convert both free throws. And now Kilberg going to start the offense. Dumped down to McCanson. Good help there from Bass to come over. And good touch. And McCanson uses a dribble there. He's going to drive. That's going to be a block. And Coach Martin and the Duhawks squad not happy with that call. I think Bass probably did beat him there. Just
It was good help defense by Bass before that as well.
Yeah.
Realizing that
right.
McCants was coming down free off of Declan, kind of leaving his defender. That's textbook help defense
right.
for man-to-man.
McCants free throw no good. Now Barry going to start the break, slow it down.
Over to Bass, a little bit of a mismatch here.
Yep, good take there from Bass, and good finish around the rim. Just like we said, and there's Bass' first bucket. That's what the Duhawks need.
Yeah, like just like we talked about, Bass got to start looking to get his own baskets. And then we talked about this earlier, Duhawks running in transition, not allowing the Spartans to set up their defense is going to be huge in this game.
Yep. And the Duhawk crowd trying to help their team here defensively. A little momentum on their side now. Kilberg's just trying to go to work on Curlick. Good move, and
wow,
finish from Kilberg.
That was a heck of a shot. And he slowly just backed Declan down into the post. I'm kind of surprised Declan got put down so deep into the post.
So far, yeah. Pearson almost lost the dribble. Arguello got a hand in there.
Great defense by the Spartans,
yes.
not allowing,
yes.
especially Brock Simon, not allowing Sabet to get that ball. And then Aguero right there denying the pass.
Yeah,
they're just clamping up all of the passing lanes right now.
Yeah, so good off ball. We say they're good on ball, but looking at that there, just the pressure that they're putting on the off ball guys is swarming and making it so hard for the Duhawks to get any sort of easy possessions. Sarvis over to Barry. Barry going to get it into Curlick. 3 seconds left. He's got to get a shot up. Oh, a little Dirk fade. No good. And Anderson's going to come down with the board, and McCants going to start the break here. McCants going to drive in. A good, strong take.
That's just a tough bucket. That's just all strength right there.
So good around the rim is McCants. And just so physical that it makes it so hard for the defense to really even slow him down.
Yeah, Spartan fans kind of getting into it here a little bit. Oh, smart play by Pearson.
Yeah, good read from Pearson. Good recognition of the body, forcing him out of bounds, and good realization that Sunday John was right there close to him to throw it off his leg.
Can't believe I haven't touched on this yet. Such a cool name.
Sunday John.
That is
pretty sweet.
Elite name.
Yeah.
And he's kind of a hooper, too.
Oh, yeah.
Which makes it even cooler.
Hand off Sabet. Sabet going to try to drive left, but Anderson just a wall
all over him.
Oh. Deep three from Sabet. No good. It's off the front iron, and now McCann's going to start the offense for the Spartans. Anderson kind of open down low, but a missed opportunity. McCann's drive. Good defense from Curlick.
Oh.
McCann's trying to draw a foul there, but no, refs are saying nothing there. And Molstead almost turnover there. A good read by McCann's to get a touch on that pass.
I may have possibly been able to see an official calling a foul there with Declan's hand kind of stuck in there on the cans.
Molstead also with zero. Duhawks, I'm sure, hoping to get him going at some point. With a minute left in this first half.
Duhawks got to get the ball to Tyler Bass right now.
Three-pointer no good, and Bass able to come away with the rebound.
Good
strong take, and he's unable to finish at the rim.
Yeah, the Duhawks should have, I think they should have, maybe Ali should have worked that ball around one more. That's not, personally, I don't think that was a very good shot by Ali, especially with Tyler having the much smaller defender Kilberg on him.
Right.
As we saw him get the rebound on Kilberg right there and then draw the foul.
Yeah, now Bass going to go to the line for two. Bass, a 78% free throw shooter. And is able to get the first one to go.
Yeah, and free throws already playing a huge part in this game. UD, 4 for 9, already missed 5. Duhawks, knock on wood, 6 for 6 coming into this free throw right here.
pass, able to get that one to go. You can see it on your screen too, but looking around, the AWC.
Pretty full.
Pretty full.
Pretty full, I'd say.
I mean, why wouldn't it be for this crosstown rival? Good find. McCann's throwing it down once again.
Yeah. Second dunk of the game, yeah. And really big momentum shift. Dunk is always a big shift.
And, I mean, just great awareness from Kilberg to see McCann's wide open and just dump it down to him. And it's going to be last touch by the Dewhawks. It's going to be Spartan ball. And, again, right now it is just all Spartans here. And there's a two-second differential between the shot clock and the game clock, so the shot clock will stay on.
Yeah, I would expect UD to just take this shot with about one or 2 seconds left on the shot clock here. Kind of surprised this Duhawk crowd isn't getting into it here with this last 20 seconds here on the shot clock of the half.
Right.
Oh, there
now
we go.
Going to
they heard me.
Yep. Yeah, Kilberg just dribbling it out a little bit. Barry just letting him do so. Now Barry going to try to get a little pressure on him. Anderson's going to set that screen. Kilberg, deep three ball.
Oh, wow. That's a heck of a shot by Kilberg.
Sirlik?
Oh! Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness.
That's just – I hate to use this word, but that's – partially just lazy defense on UD's part.
Yes.
They kind of let that time go by, and then that was a heck of a shot by Declan.
Well, and for the pass to come from the inbound on the baseline to allow the pass to get a one bounce into the hands of Kerlick to turn around and then shoot it. I mean, you might want to have a little more pressure on that, but, I mean, that's exactly what the Dewhawks needed going into the half. A big-time shot to maybe get some momentum on their side for the second half.
Yeah, and who said the bank is closed at 4:38 on a Saturday? Declan Kerlick doesn't believe that one bit. Can't say I blame him.
I didn't say it. Wasn't me.
Oh, maybe I'll try to catch one of these T-shirts at
and
halftime.
And with 14:30 on the clock for half, Dewhawks trailing at 32-28, and we'll be back in 14 short minutes. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Lillis Court in the AWC on the campus of Loras College for this crosstown rival matchup between the visiting University of Dubuque Spartans and the Loras College Dewhawks. First half, pretty much what we expected, high intensity, very physical in the first half, and the Spartans leading at 32-28 in this matchup. Yeah. Hugh, your takeaways from that first half.
Yeah, it was a great first half, high energy. The Dewhawks shot 4 of 13 from 3, but maybe the biggest 3 coming at the end of the half from Declan Sirlik, as we'll see the replay of it right here. And we talked about it, just lazy defense with the bounce pass, and Declan, don't see it go in, but you see him shoot it, and then the reaction should be enough for everybody now that ball went through the hoop.
Yeah, I mean, you said it there. The pass from Bass, able to just UD, allowing it to just get one bounce, and Sirlik able to just get it with such ease and have such an easy chance to put it up from half court. And then, the reaction, just draining it off the backboard.
Yeah.
And I think that's exactly what, like you said, what Loras needed. They needed some sort of spark. It was a pretty flat first half.
Yeah.
Not only from the team unable to get shots to drop, but, like, getting the crowd into it as well. That's huge for the Dewhawks.
And a seven-point game is a lot different than a four-point game, as I feel like that needs to go unsaid.
Right.
But I said it anyways.
And
the Dewhawks are also winning the rebound battle.
Yeah.
I talked to you at halftime, like, surprised that we are winning the rebound battle by 6 rebounds and we're still losing the game, as I'm a big believer in rebounds will win teams games.
Yeah, and it's been a quiet night for some key Dewhawk players. I'm Molstead, one of those guys, currently 0 for 5 from the field. Obviously, 0 points, hasn't gotten to the line yet, but I'm sure we'll see that change. I'm sure Molstead will get one or two to drop. And that's going to build that momentum for the Dewhawks. And then Ali Sabet having a quiet half for him. Props to UD doing whatever they can to make his life very difficult on the offensive side. Only at 5. Miles Berry having a fantastic game for himself. 8 points in the first half for him. And then on UD, Jalen McCants leading his squad like he does in points with 11 with the game high.
Yeah, and partially Ali only scoring 5 points was he got those two quick fouls that really kind of disrupt. I mean, you pick up 2 fouls early, it's going to disrupt you that whole – that's the half.
Right. Bass going to drive and just unable to finish at the rim.
Kind of short arm that one.
Yeah.
I think he expected a little bit more contact than what was there.
Right, and I think he saw McCants, and I think he was, like you said, the contact, but he saw McCants expecting that – help from McKenzie, because McKenzie's a very physical defender.
Extremely physical.
The
way for the Duhawks to win this second half is just flat out they have to make their shots. They're doing everything right on defense. They just got to hit their shots.
And, yeah, again, their defense, like you said, everything right. Curlick, fantastic D on McCants.
Ooh, might have traveled there a little bit.
Yeah, and it's going to be a foul on John. I mean, good awareness there from Basso. Knew he was going to fall over and travel.
Yeah.
Just put the ball down on the ground quick, able to get John to draw draw the foul. And that's going to be – oh, excuse me, they're calling that on Anderson. That's Anderson's second.
Yeah, and Anderson – talk about having a quiet half. He had 0 points in that first half.
Yeah, and Anderson, again, another leader for this Spartan squad. Very capable of shooting from deep and finishing around the rim. Molstead's going to go to work on him. Drive left, feed to Bass. Bass gets strong take. Unable to finish there, and Duhawks want a foul, but are not going to get one now that Spartan's going to start the break here. Simon.
A little bit of a mismatch right here.
Yep. Simon's three-pointer, no good. John, that's going to be a foul. Just – boosting off of Molstead's back. John, we talked about it, a very good athlete. Probably didn't need to jump and use the shoulders of Molstead. He's already super athletic to get up there.
And going back to that last session that we just saw from the Duhawks, once again, it was them running out in transition, not allowing this Spartan defense to set up and find their matchup on defense.
No.
As, I mean, Ali Sabet just hit a back cut there, and Brock Simon was in his jersey that whole way.
Yep. Yeah, Simon, a very good defender. Especially off ball. Like we said, he's super athletic, super quick. And Sabek step back three-pointer.
Shot.
Oh!
He starts making those. The Duhawks have a good chance at winning this game. I mean, that's an extremely difficult shot to make.
Yep.
As that got that, they have the crowd back into it as well.
Yeah, and that's exactly what Loris needs here. Oh. And just a fantastic find and such an easy bucket for Kilbergen. Definitely miscommunication on the Duhawk defensive side.
And that's one of the rare times that you'll see a miscommunication on this Duhawk defense. Over the season, especially today, they've played pretty sound, tight defense. That's really one of the few mistakes they've made.
Right. Molstead over Sabet. Sabet, three-pointer. No good. It's a good look, but unable to get it to drop. And now Kilberg going to start the offense. Lob up to McCants. Oh, good one-handed grab. Now kick it out to Kilberg. He'll shoot the rock. That one's good.
Yeah, and smart awareness there by McCants. Even though he did have the much smaller defender Molstead on him, he saw Kilberg for the wide-open shot.
Yep. Right now, it's a lot of momentum on the Spartan side. Sabet going to drive right, goes in, and just unable to finish around the rim. Maybe expecting some contact there, but that's going to be
got to be offensive.
Offensive.
No?
Oh, we're going to call it on the ground, and it's going to be on Bass.
Oh, interesting. Usually when you see a player do a full arm shove,
it almost looked like a little extension there, but it's not up close, and now it's going to stay Spartan ball. They're going to get it down low, and 26 seconds on the shot clock. Haynes and Pearson also check back in.
Yeah, this Duhawks team has kind of come out a little sluggish here out of halftime. UD's came out with a lot more energy that we saw that earlier in the game as well. There's a lot of contact there.
I mean, that's just so good from Kilberg, and just able to stay strong with the ball there. And, a lot of contact there. I think Curlick definitely had a nice grasp on his forearm there, but able to just body through the contact and finish at the rim. Piercing a drive right on Kilberg. Stop, spin, floater.
Nice. Almost thought that one made a bounce off the back of the rim there for the Duhawks. That would have been a tough blow there for the Duhawks. But doesn't matter. They made the floater.
Yes. Spartans leading at 39-33.
Yeah, that's a smart play here by the Spartans. Slow this game down.
Yeah. A little tangle up between Pearson and McCants. And good find out to Anderson. His three-pointer, no good. Short iron.
Picked the ball up instead of dribbling it.
Yeah, and Sunday John. Good hustle there, but... it's going to be last touch by him. A good poke on Molstead trying to dribble. Like you said, could have probably picked it up and tried to dribble it.
Yeah, I've never really understand it. Not picking up the ball before you try to dribble it. It just makes a lot more sense, and then you can secure the ball that way and then get going on offense.
We're going to have a timeout here. 15:57 left. And the Duhawks trailing, like I said, 39-33. And just not the offensive shooting night that the Duhawks were hoping for in that first half. And just a rough shooting night, not only from the field, but and then the three-point line as well. They're doing really well from the charity stripe, as you would expect.
It's extended that that poor first half shooting has extended into the first 4 minutes of this second half. I mean, the Duhawks are shooting 8 of 26, which is 30%. And half of their makes have came from the three-point line where they're shooting 4 of 13.
Right.
Well, actually, half their shots have come from there, as well as half their makes. So, you know, a 50-50 split, kind of, I don't know why that seems so interesting to me, that half their shots have came from inside the arc and outside. But and then they're shooting 8 from 8 from the free-throw line, like you said. So they're definitely – if they can keep getting to the line and score points without the clock moving, it's a huge advantage for them. And then I said this at the start of the half. For them to win this game, they're going to have to start making their shots, because you cannot win a basketball game shooting 30.8% from the field.
Right, agreed. And I think this is what you'd expect from the Spartans, too, coming into today's game. Obviously, when you lose at home like they did in that 76-65 loss to Loras earlier, you expect them to come out hot and curly three-pointer, short iron. So you're expecting them to come out with some energy, and we've seen it all game so far. A lot of energy from the Spartans.
Yeah, and props to them. That's just what this rivalry does. It kind of find an extra gear in these games, especially when you're playing on the road. You really want to come out here, set the tone in the rivals' gym.
Absolutely. Kilbert going to work on Pearson. Good find to John. John, three-pointer. No good. Haynes, good rebound.
Box out.
Now Pearson's going to start the break. Going to drive, and Sabet, they're going to slow it down. Molstead, three-pointer, no good. Back iron. Pearson, good rebound.
That was a good elevation there by Pearson.
And Pearson, so good on the offensive glass, just coming out of nowhere as a guard and getting those good O-boards to keep other possessions alive for Loras.
Yeah, and offensive rebounds are such a huge factor in close games, because it gives your offense – as the Duhawks turn that one over. But it gives you an extra possession on offense as the Duhawks just turn that one over.
Martin's trying to plead his case. He thought it was last touched by Spartan.
I also thought that it may look like it came off the Spartan last.
Kilberg just going to walk this one up for UD, guarded by Barry. Again, Barry's such a good defender on the guards for opposing teams. Now he's going to work on Pearson, just going to drive right on Pearson. Good D there from JP.
A lot of open people on that Spartan offense right there.
Simon, good kick to Arguello. His three-pointer, no good. Oh, good rebound from Thompson.
He got a box out.
And he's able to draw the foul, and he's going to go to the line for two.
Yeah, Duhawks have to box out. As I just talked about, Spartans need to box out on the other end as well. Mm-hmm. You can't keep letting teams get these extra possessions on offense, as now they'll be able to get two free throw attempts here.
Right, and that foul's going to be on Barry. That's going to be his second.
As there you see Coach Martin pleading his case to the officials.
Thompson at the line, an 81% free throw shooter, and he's going to miss the first one.
It's almost like an anomaly, the amount of free throws that they've missed today, shooting 40% from the line now.
And again, we saw that in that first matchup. I mentioned that UD shot 36 free throws in that game, but only made 22 of them. So, and I mean, losing 76-65, you got to think they make a couple more of those, and that game is going to be a lot tighter.
Yeah.
And we're seeing it here still, missing quite a few free throws. The lead could be a lot bigger if they make – around half of those.
Yeah, the lead
shots
would be about double digits.
Yeah. Barry catch and shoot three, high arcing. It's going to hit the front rim.
Yeah, Simon really affected that shot there for the Spartans.
Good from Sabat.
And that's a pretty much automatic shot.
Yeah,
for Ali Sabat, wide open.
Yep.
As this Duhawk crowd is looking for any chance to get back into this game.
Yep, and I think that's what they needed there a little bit. Now Thompson just going to work with Pearson guarding him, and over to Kilberg. Kilberg going to drive left. Good read. Handoff to Simon. Good strong take and a good finish from Brock Simon.
Yeah, like you said, that's great defense, almost perfect defense on Barry's part.
Yeah.
But Simon so good in the air and able to control and move his bodies in different ways.
Yep. Now Sabet going to drive left. Thought about pulling up at the midi. Decided not to, and Berry going to drive right with McCants on him. Over to Kerlick. Oh, good one more to Pearson. His three-pointer. Good.
That's just great ball movement. That's where not being a selfish player really comes in handy in the game of basketball.
Agreed. Yeah, just a fantastic one more from Kerlick. Good awareness. I mean, really, he had either side. He could have gone to his right, to, I believe, Sabet on the wing, but able to get it to Pearson in the corner. And now Simon, a step back, just three was not taken. Arguello going to drive.
Yeah, Simon may have a little bit of a mismatch there on Haynes, but I like not to use it.
I'm going to say some contact there on the Kilberg drive. It should be on the floor. Yep, and the official is pointing down. UD will take it on the baseline. Anderson, bomb over, and John all checking back in. And Tyler Bass going to come back in for the Duhawks as well.
Yeah, and everybody on the Duhawk court, except for Pearson and Sirlich just checked out, but everybody on the court at that point had two fouls except for Pearson. Yeah. So maybe something to look for later in the game. Yep. Bass has two fouls as well.
Bomb over drive. Kick over to Anderson. Anderson going to hand off to John. John lost the dribble there for a second. He's going to drive left. Oh,
wow.
Wow. He was able just to float right up to the rim and just finish so easily with a quick blow by. Oh, Pearson doing a good job selling that one there. Anderson might have cut him off there, but maybe just a little too much contact. That's going to be Anderson's third.
Yeah, and on that defensive end is a little too easy for John to get to the rim there. No help side defense and really just that first step, and it was game over for the Duhawk defense.
And especially after the loose dribble, and it's going to be foul on
looks like that's on Pearson.
I guess probably an illegal screen there.
There you see Coach Martin, once again, pleading his case.
Here's Anderson going to drive on Haynes. Dish over to John. John, we just saw make that layup earlier. And, good jab, seven drive from Anderson. Pearson,
good help. Get on the ground.
Loose ball, and it should be I think we're going to get a jump.
I would believe so.
Regardless, it's going to say UD ball.
Yeah. Based off the standing around, I'd assume
it's a jump.
They're just looking for something to clear up all the sweat.
Again, Duhawks trailing at 44-39 with 12:09 left in this second half. Sabet and McCants both with the game high 11. Excuse me, Kilberg's got the game high with 14.
I think, the Spartans should look to give Brock Simon the ball with Sabet guarding him.
Yep. And drive left. Good kick out to Anderson. Anderson's three-pointer. Good.
It's a big first bucket for Anderson to extend this one to an eight-point lead.
Yeah, like you said, I mean, that's exactly the three that you want from Anderson to get started in a situation like this. Sabet, good drive and good floater.
Yeah, Ali's really going to have to start looking to get his own buckets here. And then once he starts making them, that Spartan defense is going to almost have to collapse on him. Send another man he can look to pass the ball.
Oh, Haynes.
Oh, man.
Going to send that one flying on bomb over left-handed layup. And Singleton's going to check in for Haynes.
Yes, first time we've seen Singleton check into this game as well.
Yep.
Coming off an injury, his role is kind of cut down a little bit this year than last year.
Just another good physical big for the Duhawks, who's very coachable and will do a lot of things correctly. And Anderson's three-pointer, no good. And Singleton, there he is, getting his first board. And now Barry's going to start the break.
That's what the Duhawks need to do to get back into this one, is not let this defense set up and keep it moving.
That's going to be a foul there on McCants. I mean, a good awareness from McCants. The idea is there, just a little late trying to jump that pass.
Yeah.
Good smart read, trying to jump it, but just, like I said, just too late, and that's going to be his second. And Arguello is going to check in for McCants.
Yeah, and Anderson playing with three fouls right now. Maybe look for the Duhawks to try to attack and pick up that fourth.
Yep. But Anderson does a very good job at times going when you go into the paint of staying straight up and saw bet three-pointer. No good. Rim in and out.
Oh, there's his fourth.
It's going to be
That's Anderson's fourth, I believe.
I don't know if they, I don't know if they called a foul. I think they're saying it was.
Oh, I thought he
last.
He pointed at him.
I think they're pointing. I'm just saying it was last touch by Anderson on that.
Okay. Double team here.
Pearson, yeah, with the double. Someone's open. It's Barry. Barry, three-pointer. Good!
Yeah, now this crowd's really going to get into it. They can kind of smell the Duhawks itching back into this game.
And we saw big shots like this from Barry in last year's matchup here against UD. Getting some big ones. Now the Lohr students trying to get in this now.
Yeah, they got Get Loud on the whiteboard.
Yeah, pounding on the bleachers here. Simon, guarded by Singleton, over to Arguello. Arguello going to drive, good spin.
Travel.
A little travel maybe, but it's a good take from Arguello.
Smart timeout by Coach Sieverding right there as well. Not allowing the Duhawks to get back, and he'll be able to set up his defense.
Right, I mean, that's just a tough take from Tatum Arguello there. He's got six this evening.
And mostly all six of his points have come on Sabet as well.
Yep. And then the Duhawks just really unable to break this five-point barrier, it seems. They come within two or three, and then UD just comes right back and scores another bucket to keep the five-point gap.
That's kind of what we saw in their game against Co. That me and you were on the call for as well.
Yep.
They would get just in striking distance a one-possession game, and then they'd give up a bucket, give up another bucket, and then they wouldn't be able to answer until maybe two or three minutes later when they're down by seven.
And 10:25 left on the clock. And again, just a big three there from Barry, trying to get this crowd into it as much as he can. But right now, it's just UD just able to maintain that lead. And they're doing such a good job with getting such easy buckets, you could say, at times.
Yeah. They do get a lot of easy buckets. They're just, they've just looked a lot quicker than the Duhawks today, and that's allowing them. I mean, we saw the one with Sunday John just blew right past Pearson the first set. Nobody was there to help.
Right.
But a lot of times when teams start struggling on offense, I mean, the Duhawks have kind of been heating up here, but they often kind of maybe switch to a press or a zone, and I know Coach Martin has been prone to do that every once in a while when he feels like they need to get some momentum going. So I wonder if he has that in the works at some point before the five-minute mark maybe.
Yeah. Now Bass up top, trying to get into Pearson, but is unable to. Try to get a handoff to Sabet, and now Singleton and Bass are going to go back and forth. And going to be a turnover in Arguello. Good hand, and going to be a foul on Bass.
Yeah, that was just a tough pass. You heard me kind of make a little bit of an oh-no noise there, and that's just miscommunication there by the Duhawks.
And Arguello just reading it the entire way, just could read the eyes of Bass, knew where he was going, and able to jump out. Lost his dribble a little bit. We might have seen some fireworks with the dunk there from Arguello because he is a very good athlete as well for this Dubuque team. And another missed free throw for the Spartans. The second one, good. It's going to be last touch by the Spartans. And the UD bench. Thought it might have been last touch by a Duhawk, and now Curley going to check in for Bass.
Yeah, and the Spartans believe they're now shooting 5 of 13, so 8 missed free throws right there.
Sabet with Simon on him. They're going to hand it off to Sabet.
This is a big possession right here for the Duhawks.
Curlick three-pointer. No good. Just long. Pearson almost got a touch on it, but Arguello able to get a strong rebound there. Now Kilburg's just going to walk it up for the Spartans.
Yeah, and I feel it's only a matter of time until Coach Martin puts Molstead back into the game.
Yeah.
And then along with that, Bass as well.
Oh, good move there from Kilburg. Going to drive. Lost his dribble.
Barry.
Yeah, just fantastic defense. A kick out to McCants. McCants going to work on Curlick. Oh, good find and a good cut from Anderson. Just so strong down low. Just blown right by Singleton on the back door. And a good find from McCants, able to just dish it down to him.
Yeah, and he's almost automatic from that point as Anderson.
Yep. Saw a bad kick over to Curlick. Now backstop bad. He's going to drive right. Ooh. Sabet may have just lost his footing there, but they're going to call a foul on Arguello, and that's going to be his second. And there's Molstead.
Coming in for Pearson.
Timeout from Coach Martin. Duhawks trailing at 51-44 with 9:01 left on the clock.
Yeah, Coach Martin's going to be looking to draw up a play here, as I saw him telling the official asking where the spot was. And I'd almost have to think this ball is either going to Ali or Molstead coming out of I'd say right around the S for the Duhawk.
Yeah, and a Molstead three ball or just a bucket for Molstead could
huge.
Get some fireworks going for the Duhawks.
Yeah, and that's kind of what the Duhawks need right now, is get some momentum and energy back on their side.
And that's what you get out of Molstead. Have you seen it? We saw it in the Cove game, too, that we were on the call for. Knocking down a couple triples super early and getting the momentum up and getting the crowd into it so fast. And that's exactly what you want from your senior guard. Refs blowing their whistles. After the first horn sounded, UD's making their way out of their respective huddle. Loris getting their break. And the action will be back underway. And it's going to be Duhawk ball down on the baseline. There's Kerlick there on your screen. He's going to inbound it for the Duhawks. Out to Sabet. Now Duhawks just going to work. Barry,
nice.
Good up fake. One dribble. No good on the three.
That was a good job by Barry using that pump fake and somewhat creating his own shot.
Yeah, and I mean, it's a good read there from Barry. Good awareness to take that three. Kilberg's going to try his
own.
No good. Off the rim. And John, good hustle. And great hustle from John and throwing off a singleton. Great. I mean, good awareness.
That's just his athleticism coming into play there, too. You just saw him sprint past about two Duhawks.
Yep.
As Haynes comes into the game for Singleton.
Yep. Simon going to get it to Anderson. Now Anderson just going to get the offense going. Oh, Haynes tripped over maybe Barry.
I think they kind of tangled ankles.
Haynes' three-pointer, no good. Almost got a wedgie there, and Anderson's going to put up a layup. And he's so strong down low. And just not a rebound the Duhawks can afford to give up there.
Yeah, and Miles didn't really come off his man there. I don't know if he thought that ball was going to bounce a little bit differently. But Anderson also had great position on Haynes down low.
Haynes going to go to work. Left-hand hook. Oh, good.
Nice little soft baby hook there, just laying it over the rim.
Duhawks trailing at
53-46.
Duhawks got
to make him pick this ball up. It's just eating up time.
Kerlick does there, and McCann's going to start the offense. Coming up that left side. John, guarded by Molstead. John, a super quick, shifty guard. And Anderson's three-pointer, no good, just off the front iron. And now Sabet going to start the break in the offense for the Duhawks.
It's a good rebound by Ali, especially since he doesn't have to pass the ball to start the transition on offense.
Right, and Anderson points. Such good
defense
on Sabet there. Now here's Molstead, guarded by John. UD playing such good defense on the guards outside the three-point line. Swarming defense.
Yeah, and these Duhawk screens, they're not putting a body on anybody as well, making it a little easy for them to get around them.
Haynes hook, no good. Anderson coming down with a big man board there. Now Kilberg just going to hold it here for a little bit, just going to get the offense going slowly for the Spartans. Going to look to feed McCants, but Kerlick able to stay in front. Now Simon going to go to work on Sabet. Dish over to Anderson. Oh, good. One more there, and John's going to drive on Haynes. Simon going to try to smack it out, and he does, and Kilberg able to get out there for the ball, and Duhawks just giving up so many offensive boards late in the second half, and that's just not what you want for Loris.
And
not so easy. It is so easy for Kilberg.
Yeah, Spartans starting to pull away here. It's only still single-digit game, 9 points, but this is a very large 9 points.
We'll take a drive, and that's going to be Anderson's fourth. Not happy there. Seemed like could have maybe been a lot of ball there.
Yeah, he's taking himself
out of the game right now.
He knows he's going to have to go sit for just a few minutes, and I believe they're going to bring Grady Thompson in for him.
As obviously he's going to have to wait till the first free throw.
Yeah. And Molstad now on the board with his first point. Maybe give him a little confidence to see one drop, even from the free throw line, just see something go in.
Yeah, just seeing, like you said, anything going in is definitely a boost of confidence when you haven't gotten on the board yet.
Molstad able to get both the drop. Pearson is going to check in for Molstad, and Bass also checked in for Haynes.
Yeah, I'd expect Molstad to get maybe a two-minute break here, game time, and then check back in. Because he,
agreed,
even if he only has 2 points right now, he's still a key part of this Duhawk offense. And
yeah,
he's gotten you this far into the season. You got to ride him out.
And like I said, definitely a spark plug on offense. Yeah. Just need a couple threes out of him. Yeah. McCants, good jump hook. No good,
great
John.
Great defense by Miles.
John able to try to get a possible old board, but Sabet's able to come away with the defensive rebound. And now the Duhawks going to try an offense. Sabet, three-pointer. No good, just long.
Oh!
The ref's gonna say last touch by
I don't know
Bass.
About, I don't know about that one.
Coach Martin is letting him hear it right now.
Yeah, he almost got a technical there as well. The official gave him that stare.
Yeah,
but I mean, I can't say I blame Coach Martin right now.
Yeah, he just now the crowd gonna let the officials hear it too, but. The Duhawks now with a big stop here after that possession. Thompson down low, going to work on Sabet. Good spin, drive. Good read from Bass. He's going to get the turnover. He's going to drive, and he's going to draw the foul. He's going to go line for two, and that should be goaltending. That definitely should be goaltending.
I don't know how that wouldn't be goaltending.
By no means should that not be goaltending.
That is like textbook goaltending of the rule book.
I mean,
the ball, he shot the ball. The ball was on the way down. Sunday John came in and knocked the ball out of the air. I don't know in what world that is not goaltending.
Grabbed the rim.
Yeah. Like, I mean, Coach Martin is fired up, and I can't say I blame him.
Yeah, and Bass unable to connect on his first free throw, and Anderson's coming back into the game. Again, Anderson was four, so Anderson definitely going to have to be careful here.
Yeah. If he goes out of this game, that really helps out this Duhawk team in general, both on the offense and defense side.
And Bass able to draw the second one. Now McCann's just going to slowly bring this one up, guarded by Kerlick, as he has been all game. Duhawks going to need to put some pressure on there.
Yeah.
Guys bringing it up. They're just going to look to waste some time, and the fans trying to get the Duhawks into this one a little bit here.
And I think they're going to maybe need to start pressing a little bit here on defense with them bringing the ball up.
Right. Oh, good take from John, and a good block there from Barry.
Yeah, and John was talking to the crowd after that foul, and the crowd's going to let him hear it after getting blocked.
Now Sabet going to work on John, drive left. UD doing such a good job of not letting Sabet get to the rim. Now Pearson stop, pop, three-pointer. No good, and Bass, good
rebound. Tyler.
Hook, no good, and it's going to be another missed shot from Bass. Bass just unable to connect with any sort of layup down low, only 5 points. We don't see him typically miss a lot of those layups close to the bucket.
Yeah, I don't know if it's just the bigger defenders on him that's affecting his shot, but like you said, this is a rarity.
Yes. I get, like I said earlier, averaging like 12 points around 13. So to see him miss those layups, it's unusual. And a good find and a good finish for Kilberg.
Yeah. Once again, the Duhawks were clawing back into this game. And then the Spartans just extend it once again. It's an 8-point lead again. Here's Coach Martin used. Oh, I believe the Spartans called that timeout. Excuse me.
And the Spartans leading 57-49, 4:05 left on the clock. Like you said, it's been all Spartans so far this half.
There you see Coach Martin on the screen. I mean, he's kind of the definition of a player's coach.
Oh, yeah.
You'll see him doing workouts with the team out on the track. Really, when you hear a coach say he wouldn't put the players through something he wouldn't do, he kind of shows that as he does the workouts. And I think that's why the Duhawks may still have a chance to come back into this game. They love playing for Coach Martin. And he's a true player's coach and a fairly good coach at that as well.
And if the Duhawks get anything to get this fan base hyped up, Martin will
get the fans going.
We've seen in the past, and one notable one that we always talk about is the conference championship last year. Martin running out to half court.
Still gives me goosebumps.
Just thinking about it.
Jinx.
Curlick out to Pearson. Pearson going to drive left. Spin. Oh, what a finish from Pearson at the rim.
Oh, baby. And here's the press that we were talking about here. Duhawks really have to. Down by six with 3:40 to go.
Yep. And it looks like a 1-2-2 for the Duhawks, and they're going to find the middle for Kilberg, and it's going to get to Anderson. Now they're going to slow it down.
Yeah, that's a smart play by Kilberg. Yeah. He had the wide-open layup, and smart to burn the clock.
Yeah, and the Duhawks going to have to play swarming defense here and just put a lot of pressure on UD, trying to force turnovers, get the ball back.
Yeah, they really have to optimize their offensive as well. Whew. Oh, Coach Martin's fired up now.
Kilberg able to draw the foul on the three-pointer, and, yeah, Martin letting the officials hear it. Assistant coach.
They're really letting them
Sorensen
get away with a lot.
Assistant coach Scott Sorensen having to hold Coach Martin back on that.
Yeah. Oh, and the fans are letting them know as well.
Yeah. And Kilberg's going to miss that first one again. We said earlier, Kilberg only 53% from the line. Made two earlier.
Yeah.
He's missing the first one here. These are big free throws that he needs to make too. And he gets the second one to go.
If he only makes one here, that's huge break for the Duhawks.
Yeah.
When he could have made three. Doesn't matter, he made two.
Makes two of them, and Spartans leading at 59-51 with 3:18 left here in the second half.
Yeah, Duhawks really, really need to score on almost every possession here to get back into this one. Do.
Feeding to Bass. Nearly traveled there. Yeah, probably could have been some contact. He's going to go to work inside. And good finish there from Bass. Like we said, there's the finishing ability from Bass close to the bucket. Nice. Barry, good steal there from Barry. And a great timeout call. And that's going to get the momentum on the Duhawks side, and the fans now getting into it.
Yeah.
The students in front of us there, you can see them on your screen, trying to keep the momentum alive for Loris.
Oh, swag surfing coming on.
But you can't take away the fact Barry, that's such a good steal from Barry. Great awareness. And Bass making it hard for Simon to get a good pass in. Kind of a weak bounce pass to the corner of all places.
The Spartans were even doing kind of a little bit of a loophole, letting the ball just sit there and run more time off the clock.
Right.
So,
And just a weak pass from Simon. And, like I said, at the corner of all places.
Yeah, that's
and
not
no
where
man's
you want
zone
that ball.
And a press. Yeah, not it's the last way you want to put it, but Barry, just fantastic hustle, able to get that steal. And now give the Duhawks another possession, trailing by six with 2:55 left. Crowd in front of us getting into it with
they're hitting
swag
the
surf.
The surf of the swag is what they're hitting right now.
Assistant coach for UD wiping up some sweat. Pause for a second there, and Barry going to get in Sabet. Sabet still guarded by
Huge
Simon.
Possession here.
Going to drive. Layup no good. And again, Sabet missing at the rim. Such an unusual miss for Sabet.
I mean, Ali only with 13 points. That's a decent amount of points for somebody whose name is not Ali Sabet.
Right.
And it's not like he's, I mean, he's been getting his shots. He's been getting his looks. It's just been one of those days where it's not going through the hoop.
Not dropping. And Bass going to pick up his fourth foul. And it's going to put Kilberg at the line. Spartans in the bonus. And he knocks down the first one.
Kilberg with 21 points now.
Yeah. Again, such a good
kind of a quiet 21 as well.
And he said he's coming off of a 32-point performance from Central a couple games ago. So a very good guard, really facilitating and scoring for the Spartans.
Yeah, and he's been extremely well on defense.
Yes. And a good read there from Simon. Sabet tried to go down and use a double screen, but Simon able to come up and stop that opportunity.
Duhawks are taking a lot of time to get a shot up.
Yeah,
there.
And I mean, that's UD's great defense too. Good find and a good almost finish from Bass.
And Anderson.
Anderson's going to foul out. And again, like you mentioned earlier, that's a key player for the Spartans to lose. Again, just a physical body in low, down low, just a physical presence for the Spartans, and that's going to relieve some pressure off the Duhawk guys down low.
Yeah, and that's just a smart foul by Anderson, too. I mean, kind of going out with a bang.
Yeah.
In a blaze of glory, as some people would say.
Right.
But, I mean, now Bass has to shoot two free throws instead of having a free 2 points.
Right.
And, yeah, he's going to get a well-deserved hand by these Spartan fans. Yes. He's had one heck of a game.
Absolutely. I mean, finishing with 7 points, obviously not their go-to guy for scoring, but just does everything else so well. Finished with 9 boards, 7 points.
And a steal.
And one steal, yeah, you said it. But just so physical down low and such a good defender. And it.
But Duhawks going to have to capitalize on this, and they're really going to have to pick up this pressure here on the press.
Take major advantage of that.
They really got to force the balls into the corner. They got to keep the ball out of the middle of the basketball court. As we saw what happened earlier, Kilberg got right by him. You got to trap him right there.
Now they're just going to let them bring it up. They're going to try to get a trap here. The D from Sabet, not to get a foul, and it's going to be a good trap here. And Simon traveled there, I believe.
Oh, five. No.
Oh, and they got the timeout call. Wow, Simon.
Getting bailed out.
Oh, yeah. That's another one.
We definitely traveled.
We saw a bailout with Pearson earlier.
Yeah.
And now possibly a bailout there for the Spartans. I mean, definitely lost his balance. And you could see his pivot foot move.
Yeah. And it wasn't a slight move. It was pretty egregious move.
But, I mean, a fantastic trap from the Duhawks to get close to having that travel. But, again, just, I mean, a good timeout call for Simon, too.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's on the bright side for the Duhawks, this is a kind of tough inbound position here, especially with the student section right behind the inbounder for the Spartans. I assume Simon will be inbounding it here for them, as he's probably one of the better passers out there for them. Oh, and something to note, I just noticed this. I don't know why it took me 18 minutes into the second half, but Simon had a white wrap on his right knee in that first half, and I don't know if he felt he was being restricted or not, but he hasn't had it on this whole half, I'm just now noticing.
Good pressure here from Barry. He's going to have to keep it going, though.
Yeah, got to try to force a count here on defense, and that's a tough shot.
Oh, wow. I was going to say.
Yeah.
That's a... It's late, but it's the right call.
Yeah.
A late foul call, but it's
you
it's
see that a lot.
Right
you see that a lot where if it happens, if they make it, the officials let it play on, and then obviously we saw there he missed it.
Yeah.
Kind of like in soccer, you see the officials talk about player having the advantage. If they lose the advantage, then they stop it and redo it.
Yeah, the fans not happy about it, and Curling not happy with it. But definitely, I mean, they're probably
you can see the extension of Declan's hands.
Probably
there.
More upset about the fact that it was called so late, but definitely the right call from the officials.
Yeah, and a lot of times officials do get grief for that, but it's
the
smart thing to do, I'd say.
Yep, and McCants so good from the line this game, able to knock down both. Minute 50, Duhawks trailing to 63-55. Got to get a couple buckets here. Quick and some stops. Barry going to drive.
Yeah, the Duhawks can't really look for that perfect shot. You're going to have to start get it going.
Oh, good. Timeout from Martin there.
That was a close
timeout
as well.
Yeah. Almost close to a travel for Pearson, too.
I think Pearson's bailout there was that he kept his dribble going.
Yes.
I think it was his saving grace.
And again, Duhawks losing 63-55, minute 37 left in this contest. But again, can't emphasize enough, this is exactly what you'd expect in a nice old-fashioned rivalry.
Yeah. I mean, this is what
you play the game for. It's what you play any sports for, is for these big rivalry games. And no matter the outcome, it's always fun to be here. And obviously,
absolutely,
the team that loses is going to think it wasn't fun. But
right.
I mean, you're here at the game, you're having fun during it, and obviously the outcome's always going to affect it. But.
Could almost say this rivalry is as big as Duke versus UNC.
Well, yeah, sure, let's go with that. Yep, let's go with that. We got the Cameron crazies right here in the student section. Still can't believe you just said that. I'm so
both teams out of their respective huddles. Barry's going to inbound it from the baseline.
Yeah, they need to get a shot up here within 5 seconds of the clock.
Okay, oh, good hand. And oh,
that's
right on the ball. But, I mean, such a good hand from Kilberg.
Pearson's lucky that his ankle didn't get twisted there.
Yeah,
his foot landed straight on the ball.
Yeah, definitely very scary landing for Pearson, like I said.
Yeah.
Straight on the ball.
Yeah, Molstead hasn't played at all after that six-minute mark. He got subbed out, which is kind of surprising.
Simon's got to get it in. He does. Quick pass back to Simon. And now Thompson.
They're going
to
go
wide open. Good foul there from Curley. That should be on the floor.
Yeah.
But regardless.
McCants wanted the lob there. He's pointing up to it. And
I thought
he may have got it.
And there's Molstead checking in now with Sunday John.
Yeah. If
Curley fouls out.
Yeah. McCants would have got that dunk there. That would have been the nail in the coffin.
That would have. Lit some fireworks for the UD side, for sure. Kerlick, also kind of an off night for him as well. Only 5 points and only a few rebounds. So definitely an off night for Declan.
That's been the story of this game. It's just an off night for everybody. I mean, this Duhawk team shooting 33% from the field, 17 of 51.
Yep.
And that's just not going to win you basketball games.
No, and Thompson able to get both to drop. And now the Duhawks, you can see a little sense of urgency here on offense. And Molstead thought about shooting the three, doesn't. Duhawks taking so long. And Sunday John almost with a nice little poke.
And he had nobody in front of him either.
Almost taking the cookies away from Pearson.
As I believe Molstead. He fouled out as well as at his fourth, and they're just taking him out.
I think they might be doing a quick some offense defensive switch. So just bring in Sarvis for the defensive stops, and then bring in Molstead for that offense. Pearson able to get the first one to drop. And Duhawks trailing at 65-56. Minute 19 left.
Some of the fans starting to head for the exits here as well.
Pearson's second one, no good, and not a free throw that you can afford to miss there. And very good.
Way
to get
jump
a hand
ball
in there.
Yeah.
Great jump ball. And it's going to stay Duhawk possession. Yeah, and here comes Molstead. They're going to do that quick offense, defense switch. Sarvis going to check back out. I'm sure he's going to come right back in here shortly.
Coach Sieverding didn't look overly happy with his players there allowing that jump ball to happen and give the Duhawks an extra possession.
I think UD is going to be doing the same thing between Sunday John and Tatum Arguello. Inbound to Pearson. Pearson going to go to work here on Thompson. Spin, drop step. Good finish and one.
That's a big bucket there from Pearson. Keeping that door just slightly cracked.
Yes.
The tiniest of slivers right now.
Yeah, that's a big... Big and one there for Pearson. This would be huge for him to convert this. There he is on your screen, walking up to that charity stripe.
Yeah, if he makes this, cut it down to a two-possession game.
Yeah. And it's good. Able to convert the three-point play, and here comes Sarvis in for Molstead.
Yeah, Duhawks, I think they really should try to push this ball into the corner on either end here. Oh, wow. Aaron Rodgers.
Nice pass down court to Arguello. Could find a Kilberg and out. That's a good foul from Pearson there.
Man. That was a dime by Brock Simon.
Yeah. Absolute dart from Simon. And now Kilberg going to go to the line for the Spartans.
That's Brock's baseball background coming into play there. He's played all 4 years. Actually started at a JUCO to play baseball, transferred to UD, played basketball, and he still plays semi-professional baseball in the summertime around town.
And an unfortunate miss there for Kilberg, again, doing so well from the line. I believe 6 of 8 now. And the second one's good. 66-59, Spartans leading it with a minute 5. Kilberg with a nice 23 points.
Yeah, that's been the saving grace for the Spartans today. And the Duhawks, once again, are taking way too long to get a shot up here.
Good drive for Molstad. And one!
Yeah, it's Sunday John's fourth foul there, and that's, once again, putting some life back into this Duhawk team.
Again, just that five-point barrier the Duhawks have been unable to break.
Chance to cut it down?
Four.
To four.
Yep. And that's just the kind of spark that you need from Molstad there. So shifty and crafty around the rim, able to finish through contact like we just saw. Now Molstad with a chance to convert the three-point play. And he does.
That's huge. That's huge because it gives the Duhawks an extra point as well as allows Sarvis to come in for Molstad and keep Molstad in the game with his four fouls.
Wide open is McCants. Going to throw it down. I mean, what a good play call from the Spartans. Force all sorts of confusion, and McCants wide open down court. And just another beautiful pass from Simon on the inbound.
Hey, I got to have better communication there as well. Got to have better communication on that. For that to happen two times in a row is a tough look.
Yeah, and Coach Martin was not happy about it, too, after he saw the pass down. And
can't say I blame him.
Yeah, and just glad to see McCants okay there after
that was
a scary fall there.
That was scary.
Yeah. Bass getting him up in the air and then going, just slightly taking his legs out. But glad to see he's okay. And now Bass at the line. Going to knock it down.
Two big free throws coming up here. One free throw. But Pearson also just got a quick pit stop, got a quick tape up on the knee there.
Yep.
And the Duhawks got to stay in front here.
Oh, and
Kilberg was
open again. Down court, and it's going to be foul on Sarvis. Sarvis just too slow to cut him off there.
Sarvis probably should have made just a beeline to the sideline there and not allow McCants to go anywhere with it.
Yeah, and McCants earlier, 2 of 5 from the line. The Duhawk fans going to try to get loud here on the free throws. Some big free throws for McCants. Unable to get the first one to go, and that's a big miss for the Duhawks, Now 2 of 6 is McCants. 68-64, Spartans leading it with 41.7 seconds left on the game clock.
Even some of the parents are getting into it for the Duhawks, stomping on the bleachers.
Second one's
big
good.
Big free throw.
Yeah, big free throw for McCants. And again, that five-point barrier here. And the Duhawks got to try to get a quick shot here, quick bucket. Bass, three-pointer. No good, and Simon's going to come away with the rebound and find it to John, and John, and that can pretty much do it for the Spartans.
Yeah.
John, a big dunk and a good breakout pass from Simon, and Molstad almost lost the ball there. Duhawks have to get a shot up. Sabat does, and three-pointer no good, and John's going to come away with the board.
A little bit of extracurricular.
Yeah, and with 15.8 seconds left on the clock, Spartans leading 71-64. The Spartans are going to come into Lillis Court and walk away with a very big W for them as Loris and UD were close.
That just shows how good of a conference that the American Rivers Conference is, that Loris went into UD went in and beat them, as well as UD coming in here today and being
Absolutely. Lowers. Yeah, and that's going to – coming into today, Loras was sitting at third in the conference standings, UD right behind them at fourth, and now with this loss, it's going to put a question mark as
a
to
wrench.
Who's going to take the three seed in the ARC tournament to take on the six seed, which is BV.
Yeah, and I'm sure there's some sort of tiebreaker for all this, but
yeah.
I have absolutely no clue.
Yep, not sure.
I'm not even going to try to take an attempt at it. I'm not going to make myself look even more foolish than I already do.
Yeah, and we'll wait. We'll wait to see where that occurs, see who's going to take what seed.
No.
And an unfortunate turnover, and Simon's going to throw that one down. And he's going to let this Duoc crowd know it, too. And the Duoc's going to try to get a quick two, and Pearson's layup good. And again, just up court, and McCann's just going to grab it, and that's going to do it, folks. The Spartans coming into this court and taking a 74-66 victory over the Duhawks. What a win for the Spartans. Very similar wins, you can say, too. Like I said, Loras winning the first one 76-65, and UD just played a fantastic game of basketball today, first and second halves combined. And just a off night for some key guys on the Duhawks and
almost
unable to get big shots to fall.
Almost everybody on the Duhawks it was an off night for, except for Pearson, who had 17 points.
Right. And the Duhawks will fall to 20-5 overall and 11-5 in conference. And as for UD, they moved to 11-5 in conference and 20-5 overall. So very
Quite
similar season.
The same, same record.
And again, we'll see where these two teams line up in the conference standings. The third place seed, whether it be Loras or UD, will have the host site against Univista. Whoever is the four seed will have the host site against a very hot Central College Dutch team. So regardless, we will hope to see where both teams land. And after an unfortunate loss, the Duhawks can do their high fives with the fans. And on behalf of myself, Adam Rodriguez, and Hugh Maloney, we thank you all for tuning in for the last regular season action of this basketball season.